Hi there. Hi, Bedford. Another show. And sitting here with him, sitting here with me tonight is the Reverend John Gibbons from the First Parish Church in Bedford. And I thought we'd have a little talk about sanctuary, which is a subject that maybe you all know about, maybe you don't. But I'm really interested in having this conversation because I'm on that committee. Not as regularly as I would like, but I am. And I'm concerned about, I was concerned from the beginning of this whole sanctuary thing, is what does it mean legally for the First Parish? Not only the First Parish itself, but for the people who are involved. Because I assume where the premise is that people are here illegally, they broke the law, and that's the foundation for picking them up and carrying them away. So part of what I'm interested in is your feelings and sort of our feelings about how do we justify helping a lawbreaker to further break the law. I'm taking that side just to get this conversation going.
That's fine. That's fine. I'm happy to be here, Art. Thank you for inviting me.
You're sweet.
And I want to back it up just a little bit and say that, all right, I am one of the ministers at First Parish, and we are a religious institution, and we are doing this kind of thing because we're a very this-worldly kind of church. We care less what you believe than what you do with your life and what kind of a person you are and what kind of a world we have. And our world right now is a very dangerous place in many, many ways, and particularly with our current federal administration, it's a very difficult place for some very vulnerable people, and that certainly includes the immigrant community. And you talk about them being illegal. Well, a lot of things have been illegal in this country. It was illegal for African American people to be free. And it was illegal for them to go on the Underground Railway to escape from slavery. And it was illegal for women to cast the vote. And there were some women that went to jail for that illegal behavior. And so what we're doing right now is saying that there is a fundamental injustice happening to vulnerable immigrant populations. And we are making available our place if someone is facing imminent deportation.
Right.
Let me back it up a little bit, and I don't want to speechify too much, and you can
you
get
go right ahead, John,
questions
and I'll interrupt
in
you.
Wherever you want. But for the last couple of years, we have been looking at issues of immigration, and you may recall I went to Arizona and to Mexico on a human rights trip to look at what's going on there and people who are dying in the desert. And many of these people are escaping human rights horrors in Central America and other places. And then we have had a student minister, Josh Leach, who just completed a two-year term with us. And Josh was very engaged with immigration issues. And he encouraged us to pass a resolution way before the election. It was in May or June prior to the election. And we agreed with what's called the New Sanctuary Movement. And it's new because there used to be a sanctuary movement in the 1980s helping people who were, again, escaping civil wars in Central America. But the New Sanctuary Movement is dealing with refugees from many, many places. And obviously, this is a global problem and not just an American problem. But we passed a resolution as a congregation, and we said that we would study whether we would want to physically provide sanctuary. And we studied it, and a year later, I think it was last May, we very nearly unanimously decided that we would make our space available.
Right.
And so we have, in the last few months, been renovating our space to provide a place where one person and a child, perhaps, could live if they were facing imminent deportation. And there are a whole bunch of criteria that we have about how we decide who that person would be. But that is at least a beginning of an answer to your question.
Great. So I'm in favor of, I was in favor, I'm on the committee, and I'm a longtime member of that church. And so stuff comes up that I get concerned about in the face of my liking it, that we're doing that. And that is part of the legal thing. Are there legal implications that we really need to pay attention to, or we have not? It was about, I mean, a metaphor for it is my feelings about renovating anything in that church. I mean, it's a sacred place for me, and whatever we do, I want it to be done right, and I want it to be done properly.
Right.
And I also have thoughts about civil disobedience. I've been in the military. I've always been on the sort of, on the careful side, and this felt like an opportunity for me to participate in a kind of civil disobedience. But I think that's what we're doing.
At
any number of levels, there's going to be some issue.
It absolutely is an act of civil disobedience. And, and I cautioned the congregation when we were approaching the vote to take it with that level of solemnity and seriousness, because it's not something that we do lightly. There is another historical example, and that comes out of the Holocaust. And there's that famous quotation from the Lutheran German pastor Martin Niemöller, who said, "First they came for the socialists, and I wasn't a socialist, so I didn't speak up. And then they went for the trade unionists, and I was not a trade unionist, and so I didn't speak up. And then they went for the Jews, and I was not a Jew, and so I didn't speak up.
Right.
And then they came for me, and no one was left to speak up."
Right.
And I think that's the situation that we're in right now. The people that are potentially going to take sanctuary with us are people who are very vulnerable, who are very frightened. Often they're people who have been in this country for many,
decades.
Many years. Mm. They pay taxes, and they create businesses. There is a case that's been in the papers lately, an MIT janitor, Francisco Rodriguez.
Yeah.
He created a business and was employing people. Mm. And unfortunately, at the moment, the federal authorities, ICE, Homeland Security, is pursuing this in a very blunt instrument fashion, a very scorched earth fashion of sweeping up whoever they can find. And the ones that are easiest to find are the ones who are the most law abiding.
Right. They're most obvious.
Because they're most obvious.
Yeah. And it sort of fits with our current administration, this attitude about I'm going to fix it. I'm going to fix it, he says.
I mean, again, backing up, it's unquestionable that we need to have comprehensive immigration reform. That you need to have laws, you need to have borders, all that kind of stuff. But short of that, we have a human rights crisis going on. Let me tell you one story. Tomorrow, I'm actually going to meet with a woman, and I'll keep her anonymous for the time being, but I'm going to meet with a woman who is originally from Uganda, and her father and her first husband were murdered in political violence in Uganda, and fearful for their own lives, she came to this country. She applied for asylum, and she did not get asylum. And so she overstayed her visa and just stayed here. She ended up remarrying, and she ended up having three kids. And because you have kids here, they are now American citizens. But then, not too long ago, her husband, her second husband, was deported back to Uganda. And so here she is, and she is active in her school PTO, she is a contributing member of society, all of that kind of thing, but she is very fearful that she's on ICE radar, and if push comes to shove, she may choose to come to us for sanctuary.
Do you know what the details were of why she got denied asylum in the first place? Is that known?
I don't know, and after tomorrow I may know more of that, but Many of these things are really quite opaque, and the authorities make these decisions in a capricious way, so that it's hard to tell. I mean, you know, we've got friends, mutual friends in Transylvania,
sure,
in Romania, and we try to get them to come over, and oftentimes they can't get a visa, no matter what we do. We can have letters of reference from senators, police chiefs, town managers, and it doesn't make any difference to the American embassy when they issue these visas.
So it seems like someone's sitting in a room somewhere saying no, and there's no rhyme or reason for it.
Well, particularly in the current political climate, the only acceptable answer is no. We're in a xenophobic period where here we are supposed to be afraid of everybody who is different. And ICE is only following the letter of the law, and they do that with impunity.
Yeah.
And you know, we think that in Bedford we're immune to this sort of thing, or it's not a part of us. But if you go to the businesses around 128, I mean, who's cleaning the floors? Who are the janitors? You go talk to the landscapers. Go talk to the people who are delivering our newspapers in the wee morning hours. There was a parishioner just a few weeks ago told me a story about having some painters come to her summer house, I think, in New Hampshire, and she loved the crew of painters and what they did, and afterwards she was so happy with their job, she said, how about it if we take a group photograph? And the painter said, oh, no, let's not have any photographs, because they were undocumented. Undocumented folks are working in our hotels. They are nannies. They're just in all kinds of lines of work, and they're not taking jobs away from people, but they're contributing to our economy.
Right, and you know, there's the painters and the workers and the landscapers out there who are immigrants. But there's also a whole group of people in the society who think, and I've talked to some, think we should not be doing what we're doing.
Right.
That they focus on the illegality and saying we shouldn't be involved in it. And it isn't far from this spot. There are tons of people who really respond to people who are different in a not very good way at all.
Yeah, I'm aware of that. And
and
again, I believe in laws and I believe in borders. But we need to come up with ways that are humane, that take situations into account and don't break up families.
Yeah.
That's the other thing that we're doing, is that we're breaking up families and causing much more pain and suffering and problems down the road.
Yeah. And I'm aware of buyer beware, you know that phrase?
Yeah.
Because that's what I hear. They broke the law in the first place, so why should we? I mean, it's frustrating to hear that stuff. And at the same time, understand it.
Mm-hmm.
My father was a black and white, law-abiding. Uh-huh. I mean, I was brought up that way. You don't screw with the police department.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm having my own little struggle with all of this inside of me. I totally support it. I'll fight for it.
Mm-hmm.
But inside of me, it's like, I bring up questions like, is it really going to be a problem?
Well, I mean, for most of us, if you go back a bunch of generations to who came to this country, I mean, a lot of times people were escaping famine in Ireland.
Absolutely.
They were going to be drafted by the Tsar in Russia, and they said,
forget that.
One of my
favorites, John, is we're all from somewhere else.
We're all from someplace else, but we're in the same boat now. And you know, who knows what laws there were or what laws they violated to come here way
or
back
Or whether
then.
They did it all.
Or whether they did it all. Mm. You know, I'm not an expert in the history of immigration, but I mean, there were racist laws that clearly favored Northern Europeans. We didn't want Italians. We didn't want Irish.
Right.
I mean, Italians and Irish weren't considered to be white people.
They weren't even considered to be people.
They weren't. They were no dogs, no Irish. There was the Chinese Exclusion Act
right.
That just blanket forbade Asian people from coming to the country.
Japanese internment camps.
Japanese internment camps, absolutely. And some of this stuff is in our friends' histories. It's kind of interesting when you start digging away at this and you find out why did people come to this country. So the whole notion of what's legal and what's illegal, I mean, in my way of looking at it, people are not illegal. I mean, yes, there are illegal behaviors, but there are no illegal people. And we have to have some kind of compassion for people who are escaping for their lives. So much of the southern border problem, again, has had to do with people from El Salvador and Honduras and escaping drug violence and gang violence. And you know, if it's a question of is my family going to be safe, am I going to be safe? People are willing to take extraordinary risks to save their own lives. I mean, the people who are dying in the desert, I mean, they didn't want to walk through the desert. they weren't out for a stroll. They weren't jumping the turnstile to get on the T. They were trying to save their lives. And often in trying to save their lives, they risked their lives.
Mm-hmm.
And lost. Some many have lost their lives.
So part of my philosophy about life is that we always make shit up.
Yep.
We're always making stuff up.
Yep.
And we made up a bunch of stuff about immigrants or aliens or different people. And what are we going to do? How are we going to get about the business of changing what we made up?
Right.
Because it's not fact. It's not fact. It's made up stuff.
I think that's a really good question. I mean, the one of the most fundamental made-up things is race. I mean, whether somebody is white or black or brown or whatever, I mean, racial identities are a crock.
We create differences.
We create differences, and typically those in power are the ones who set the rules.
That's right.
And, well, by the way, I am white, and what are you?
Well, that is the law, and that's it.
Yes, it's
that's
my
what
law.
I struggle with inside of myself about this stuff.
And I mean, the truth, I think, is that most often the law has functioned in support of those who have power and money.
Of course.
And
that's why we have them.
Exactly. So you know, who's benefiting right now? I mean, the people that are benefiting are the
people that are benefiting.
The immigration authorities. I mean, we can beef up the immigration authorities. We can, you know, the people who want to build walls. Boy, they're happy to make some money building walls. But it's a total boondoggle.
Absolutely, and it's immense, mm-hmm. which is part of the challenge. Mm-hmm. How do we actually make constructive change in the enormity of the amount of people involved, the amount of people in power, the laws we've made up that aren't working at all?
Mm-hmm.
It's enormous mm-hmm. when you think about it. Mm-hmm. What the hell is John Gibbons going to do about it, or Art Smith sitting in the First Parish?
It is a drop in a bucket. And here we're talking about, you know, room for one person or one person and a child. And that's not much. That's not going to change.
But the fact that we're doing it might be something that it could gain from momentum if a lot of people started doing it, don't you think?
Yes. I think if a lot of people started doing it, I mean, the point here, and I guess I should make this point too, is that...
I knew you'd have something to say.
Well, of course. and remember, well-behaved churches rarely make history. If anybody needs any bumper stickers, you know where to find them. We've got plenty of them. So we're First Parish is not well behaved, but I'm not telling you anything you don't already know.
If you're going to talk to the public, say right there.
Talk
that's
right
you
then. Well, they're catching it. Yeah, we got plenty
sorry,
of
go ahead.
All directions. There's nothing that says that ICE can't come to First Parish and grab somebody. There's nothing in law that says they can't do that.
Mm-hmm. It's only hinted.
There isn't There is a policy, it's an informal, it's an unwritten policy, that ICE is very reluctant to enter a place of worship. They're reluctant to enter a hospital. They're reluctant to enter a school. It looks bad. It looks bad to have the feds charging into First Parish, and they don't want the bad publicity for that. And I should also make the point that there's no hiding immigrants. We're not harboring anybody. Right. In fact, the very first thing we do if somebody should be with us is to write a letter to ICE and say, you know, we've got Joe Blow, and Joe Blow is at 75 The Great Road, and we're holding Joe Blow until his or her case can get resolved.
Well, that's the other piece of this. We also ask or find out whether the case has some merit or not, right?
Right. As I say, there are criteria, and we don't want somebody with a violent criminal background, for example.
Right.
We want somebody who has a plausible case. We want somebody who has legal representation. And in a practical way, what we are doing is we're buying time for that person.
Sure.
They've got legal representation, and they are arguing their case in court. And rather than face imminent deportation, we're buying them some time so that they have a chance to win. The last I heard, there were only 18 or 20 such cases across the country, and yet in every one of them, the situation was resolved short of deportation. So there's a track record of success for this approach, and we'd be working not just by ourselves, by the way. We'd be working with others. We're what is called a level one sanctuary church, meaning we're providing physical sanctuary. But there are a lot of level two synagogues, churches in this community and in surrounding communities that will be supportive of us and have already been supportive of us in making the renovations that we've had to make at First Parish. We've had to make close to $10,000 worth of renovations, and I've received out of the blue checks from Bedford residents who say that they are moved and want to contribute. They have nothing to do with First Parish, but the moral statement has caught their attention. So I just as you said, I think that that's the point. There's a moral example that's being made that we hope can move hearts, can change hearts.
Absolutely. What a good thing!
A good thing. I'm hopeful.
And full of attention.
I mean the Ugandan woman that I mentioned. She read about us in the newspaper.
Yeah.
And she came to a session that we had a couple of months ago about Know Your Rights. A woman named Susan Church, who was at that time the head of the American Immigration Lawyers Association, spoke about Know Your Rights from the perspective of immigrants so that they know what their rights are, but also for us as a sanctuary church, what are our rights, what happens if ICE comes knocking at the door, and we will have to see that they have a warrant. They just can't barge on in and grab somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And then you, just before the show went on, you were talking about the Supreme Judicial Court in Massachusetts just recently made a decision saying that police cannot pick somebody up solely on the basis of their immigration status. Immigration is a civil matter, and police are fully empowered to stop somebody for violations of the criminal code. But they are not empowered to stop somebody for a civil violation, and immigration is considered a civil violation. So this says so, that our police do not have to.
Give me an example of where you think a policeman might stop someone for a civil violation, and in the process find out the person is illegal?
Well, the worst case of this was Arizona, and what is it, SB 10? I forget the exact number of the bill, but they were stopping based on profiling. You know, if you were driving while brown, they would stop you, yeah. and if first ask about your immigration status and your papers, and if you didn't have papers, they would haul you in for that.
So if Stevie Waite stopped somebody for a speeding violation, mm-hmm. and found out in the process that the kid didn't have papers,
I think that's irrelevant to that. He can prosecute for the speeding violation, but not for the immigration issue.
And so they are now told they cannot do anything about that part of that stop. Right?
I believe that's correct.
Right.
Yeah, I believe that's correct. I mean, Bedford, some people have suggested that Bedford be a sanctuary city.
Right.
And that's what the Supreme Judicial Court ruling, by the way, does, is it gives legal support to the notion of sanctuary cities. But Bedford, I think, wisely has chosen not to buy itself the trouble of becoming a sanctuary city.
I mean, selectmen?
Selectmen or town meeting or whomever. I mean, yeah. It's just inevitably more controversy than we need to deal with.
Right.
But I believe that Chief Bongiorno has reiterated that our officers will not be pursuing immigration violations.
Right.
And so, in effect, we're a welcoming congregation, we're a welcome community, we're a sanctuary city, but not in name.
Yeah. So the hope of the world is in my faith community, who understand that everything is, that all this stuff is made up, and there's a real opportunity to be able to change it somewhere along the line.
Well, and people like you who have military background,
yeah.
Who have a strong commitment to supporting our law enforcement officers, who want Bedford to be a safe place for all people. I mean, for you to be a participant in this, I think is very encouraging, too.
Oh, good.
Yes, it is. It's helpful. It's not just a bunch of yahoos. It's not just a bunch of knee-jerk left-wing yahoos.
Oh, I bring my military life to me when I go to church.
I appreciate that.
And I try to minimize the amount of crap.
And that's a whole other subject, too, we could talk about.
Good. When you
ways to support military people.
Yeah.
In October, we're going to have Andrew Basevich be speaking. He's another Gold Star parent, but a very authoritative commentator about war, and he's a career military person.
I'm going to have Dr. Herz on to talk about PTSD.
Excellent. Yeah. That's great.
He's agreed to do it. We just got to figure the date.
That's great.
Bye, Bedford. Thank you so much for being here. I love it. John's my
Thanks,
buddy,
Bedford.
My friend, and I love him. Thank you.